So that's right, action. And then, oh, sorry, I'm looking at time. Then comes, interestingly, right, livelihood. So one might think that one had already dealt with that with right action, but obviously the Buddha, recognizing that he was often talking with lay people as he wandered around in northeast India, he met with farmers and businessmen and kings and beggars and all the different people. He would wander around, and whoever he met, he would give them talks, depending on what they were doing. He would use their particular livelihood as an example and change it round to have a Dharma context, like farmers sowing seeds and things. So he has right livelihood. And this is an interesting one. So what is right livelihood? Right livelihood basically means any kind of livelihood which doesn't harm others. So not being in working in a munition factory, for example, or in any kind of organization which is heavily involved in, you know, things which cause harm, like pesticides and things like this, or being a butcher or a fisherman, or any kind of livelihood which is connected with causing harm to other beings. This obviously, it's fairly obvious. So it's much as possible to have a livelihood which is either karmically neutral, it's neither good nor bad, like banking, or is something useful, you know, like people in the social services and so forth, you know, are nursing, doctors, psychiatrists. You know, I mean, some people have occupations which are definitely intended to be of benefit. Other people have occupations which essentially are very harmful. So not those. The ones that your benefit are good, and a lot of occupations which are neutral. I mean, they keep the economy running, but are neither good nor bad, depending on how you use them. But because we spend so much time on our job and our career, our profession, very important if we are on a spiritual path to make sure that our daily livelihood is conducive to our inner spiritual development. Right? And I think this is why the Buddha put that there, because so many people spend so much of their day on their work, and of course previously often going to university or to colleges to become proficient in whatever career they have chosen. And therefore, to be very careful that you have a career which is, if possible, helpful and at least not harmful. Because if one is in a career which you know is ultimately harming others, how can we then sit down and meditate on universal compassion and loving kindness? And then you're spending your time, you know, creating things which will be of harm to others. And a lot of people, as we know, you know, highly intelligent and you know, in work situations, which really, even if they think they're being helpful, that might be actually the means to that is harmful. Like some friends who are neuroscientists, but they test on all these poor animals. Hundreds of them. And, you know, all these monkeys and things in cages looking totally despairing. Absolutely. A hell realm. And I mean, I know that they're trying to do all these clever neuroscience things for helping. But, you know, I don't see how by harming other beings we are making the karma for healing. It's not a healing karma to torture and kill other beings. So this is why we endlessly end up with all these drugs which cause more problem side effects than the original disease, or we come up with new diseases which there's no cure for, because we're not making the karma. And so, you know, their intention is very good, they're very nice people, but I don't know how they can live and look in the eyes of these beings that they're torturing day by day. So we have to analyze what we're doing and really think clearly to make sure that such a large part of our life is conducive with our own spiritual aspirations and really is of benefit to all beings, not just human beings. Human beings are just a very small part of the whole picture. We share this planet with so many beings, apart from ourselves. And then the next is right effort. Effort here means the effort to eradicate negative states of mind which have arisen, like any negative states to dealing with greed and grasping and anger and aversion and pride and jealousy and ignorance and so forth, all those negative emotions, to prevent them, to eradicate those which are already part of our mental system, you know, that we've cultivated and have gotten in the habit of. So that when we see something, we immediately, habitually respond in a negative way, you know, either through lust and greed or through anger and aversion and so forth. Anyway, so to see that in our mind stream and make the effort to overcome it, and then likewise to prevent such thoughts coming up in the future. So looking at what's happening in our mind stream right now and cleaning it up a bit, and trying as much as possible when these negative states come in our mind in the future to deal with them. There are many, many ways of dealing with them. We can't deal with that here. But there are ways of, first we have to recognize them, right? This is a negative mind. This is anger. I'm angry. That covers irritation, frustration, annoyance, and all these other kind of underlying. But the root is anger. Okay, right now I'm feeling pissed off. Okay, fine. We accept that. We accept it, all right? I'm feeling angry. Now what? And then, you know, that goes on with the path of cultivation. Either we transform it, we transcend it, we convert it into something else. There are many, many different practices for dealing with our negative emotions, which we have no time to go into here. But anyway, the first thing is to recognize it and accept that's what you're feeling, and then how you're going to deal with it. So then the third right effort is to recognize and cultivate the goodness in our mind, the generosity, the kindness, the compassion, the joy, and all these things, and to encourage more and more for the future. So always it's dealing with what's happening now and in the past. That's what we have to recognize. It's negative or positive. If it's negative, to transform. And if it's positive, then to encourage. So we don't just look at what's wrong with us, but we also encourage what is right in us. Everybody has goodness. Everybody. So we might think, well, you know, I really have a problem with anger. I get very upset and irritated. I've got to work on that one. But I'm generous. I enjoy giving. I enjoy sharing. So this comes easy for me. Let's do more. So it's like in a garden. You have to look at the weeds and pull out the weeds. Maybe make compost with them. But we also have to water and appreciate the beautiful flowers. The garden is not just about pulling out weeds. If all we see in the garden are the weeds and we don't appreciate the flowers, So we're pulling out the weeds so that the flowers have more space to grow. But we have to water the flowers and put nice manure around it and put them in the sunshine and talk to them and say, oh, you're so beautiful. Come on, have more, more, more. Lovely, lovely. I'm going to sing. And the flowers grow. So we have to look and put sunshine and light on our good qualities. You know, and appreciate the goodness in us. Not just what's wrong, but what's right. So those are the efforts, right? To eradicate what is wrong and to encourage what is right. And then we have right mindfulness. Well, right mindfulness, of course, is now the flavor of the day. Basically, it means directing our attention to what we're doing while we're doing it. Because so often, actions which we perform, our mind is who knows where. It's not with the action which we were performing, which is the only action which is actually happening. And so to try to get our mind where our action is and to be present in here and now is the underlying motive of being mindful. In Buddhism, right mindfulness means mindfulness, this awareness, this attention, which is also focused on the wholesome. For example, if you were a burglar, then you would be very mindful, right? Walking very, open the door very quietly, walking in very quietly. Very, very mindful. But it is conjoined with negative states. It's conjoined with the idea of wanting to steal and in that way harm. And it's therefore not considered to be right mindfulness. Right mindfulness in Buddhism, mindfulness is always conjoined with positive states of mind, not negative states of mind. But it's generally, the fact is that our ordinary conceptual mind is caught up in the past or fantasizing about the future and very rarely settled in the present moment. Even if we are in the present, we're usually elaborating it and conceptualizing it and judging it and comparing it and blah, 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 talking to ourselves. We very rarely are just resting in the present moment nakedly. We don't see things nakedly. We clothe them in our preconceptions. Our stale mind. We don't see things fresh. Yet moment to moment is rising anew. But we just label it down with all our old stale thinking and habitual responses and attitudes and opinions and prejudices. And we don't see things how they really are. So mindfulness is to bring us back and to give attention to what is happening, which is, after all, the only thing which is actually happening. It's now become, of course, as I say, you know. It's funny, really, actually, I mean. In the Buddhist world, there's a lot of controversy about the growing popularity of mindfulness. Some people feel it's diluting mindfulness and just commercializing it, and that, you know, it's losing the whole spiritual dimension. And other people feel, well, as long as you're being mindful, you're being mindful. I mean, that's a good thing, isn't it? I mean, personally, I'm more on that side. I think that anybody who learns to be mindful, it's good. And also, if they Google mindfulness, they might discover it's actually Buddhist. Because, I mean, you know, Time magazine has this half-page ad for a book which they have printed, Time magazine. Mindfulness, the new science of the mind. But the Buddha said that mindfulness is the one path to liberation. And in all Buddhist schools, the ability to be aware is the central point. In the Tibetan school, from Guru Rinpoche, Milarepa, Tsongkhapa, anybody, Atisha, they all say the essential point is to observe the mind at all times. So to be mindful of the mind. The Buddha taught four levels of mindfulness. First, mindfulness of the body, because that's the easiest for us. Mindfulness of the body includes, of course, mindfulness of breath. Mindfulness of breath is very skillful. In all Buddhist schools, it's taught because, first of all, we're always breathing. Secondly, the breath is very interconnected with the mind. How we are thinking changes our breathing. If we're fearful, if we're excited, if we're, you know, angry or peaceful, the breath reflects our mental state. At the same time, we cannot breathe in the past or the future. We only breathe now. So if our attention is resting on the ingoing and outgoing of the breath without commentary, we're present. And present is the only time we have. The past is gone, the future hasn't come. The only time we have is right this moment, and then that's gone. As you think this moment, it's already last moment. So the way to bring us back into ourselves, into the present moment, one of the most skillful ways is through the concentration on the breath. And that comes under the mindfulness of the body. This Buddha started in his wisdom with trying to be mindful of the postures, of the four postures of the body, standing, sitting, walking and lying down. That we are just aware while we are walking, we know we are walking. When we are sitting, we know we are sitting. Normally we're sitting and we're thinking of everything else except that. Or we're walking and we think we're looking at things and we're thinking of things. One thing we're not conscious of is walking, unless we're in pain for some reason. And so just to bring the mind back into the body, to feel the body, the energies in the body, so simple. Anyone can do it. But it brings us back into ourselves and is perfect mindfulness. Mindfulness is not difficult. Anyone can do it. Problem is to sustain it. Because we are in the habit of being unmindful. We're in the habit of being distracted. The mind doesn't like to be non-distracted. It likes to run around. Because when we are in the present moment without commentary, there is no ego. And so this is very challenging to the ego, which will therefore do anything to get us distracted again, especially thinking up delicious thoughts we'd never thought of. Oh, that's really, I remember that, yeah. And off we go. The actual technique is very simple. The problem is to do it. Because it's simple, therefore it's become popular. And of course also for people with psychiatric problems, they've discovered that, you know, teaching people how to give it more attention, it can be very, very helpful. And how being, you know, multitasking is so bad for you. I mean, now neuroscientists have proved that it's bad for us. The brain is not intended to multitask. What is everybody looking at? Yeah, well, I better to look at Tara. She's much more interesting. Yeah, so anyway, the question of being mindful is trying to keep our attention here and now, and to do whatever we are doing with full attention to what we're doing. And so the Buddha, as I say, he suggested being conscious of our movements, or to be conscious of the breath coming in and going out. And so that leads us, I mean, and then there is the awareness of, after the body, the awareness of the sensations in the body, which is like in the Goenka Vipassana method, where they go from the top of the head to the soles of the feet, feeling the inner vibrations, the sensations. Then the Tibetans especially emphasize awareness of the mind, of the thoughts, of like being, you know, stepping back and just watching the thoughts instead of being swept along by the thoughts. And then the mental objects, the phenomena of the dharmas. So there are increasing subtlety of mindfulness. But, you know, to be completely conscious of what we are thinking, of what we are doing, of what we are saying, is a very important, very important discipline on the path in all Buddhist traditions. The mind is the most important thing. To bring the mind, to become the lords of our mind, the master of our mind, instead of the slaves of our mind. And then to transform the mind and transcend the mind, the ordinary conceptual mind, to recognize the very nature of the mind, our ultimate unborn awareness. So the last proponent is Samyak Samadhi. Samadhi means concentration and meditation. And again, this is a huge field. We can't enter into here now. But basically, it is divided into two sections. The first is called Shamatha, which means calmness, tranquility. And so that is for learning how to get the mind to become more quiet by getting the attention. Normally, our attention span is very, very short. So it's learning how to rest the mind on a single point. In other words, how to develop this quality of being mindful and aware. So normally it would start with the breath, because the breath is something very tangible, but at the same time subtle. And then once the mind is able to settle on the breath, to take the mind and turn it inside, that mindfulness, that awareness, that ability to observe without being caught up in the object, standing back from the object and observing it, dispassionately, without commentary. Then to turn that back onto the mind itself and observe the mind. The traditional example is of someone sitting on the banks of the river, watching the river going by. Normally we're in the river, swept along. Chatter, 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 chatter. I mean, sometimes I say, if we had a loudspeaker attached to our brain and everyone could hear what we were thinking, people would learn to meditate very quickly. So quietening that chatter, 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 observing it. As we observe it more and more, then it becomes quieter and quieter of itself until recognizing that these thoughts come from space and dissolve back into space again. And then once the mind has quietened down, another example which was I heard recently, one Lama said, he said it's like being in a train and seeing the scenery go by. You know, nice scenery, ugly scenery. It doesn't matter, it's all just passing. We're not getting out the train. We're just sitting in the train and watching it all go by. So it's that sense of just being aware, whatever comes, it's just passing through, and we don't have to step into it. We can just observe it while we're practicing in our formal meditation. And then after, when the mind begins to calm down and is able to be more quiet and more attention, then we do on to the second part, which is called Vipassana, which means insight, basically. It means clearly seeing. Seeing, superior seeing, really. And that is when we now, in order to get our ability to rest in deeper and deeper levels of absorption, which traditionally there was expected that the mind would go into deeper and deeper levels of non-conceptual mental absorption called samadhi. Once that is that heals the mind becomes psychiatrically very healthy. You can't get into these deeper levels of mental absorption unless the mind is very well balanced, very, very healthy mind. When the mind is so clear and vivid and one-pointed and absolutely able to be stable and clearly seeing, then we can start to strip off the skin of the onion. In other words, we turn the attention then back and start analyzing the mind. We're not trying to just be peaceful and blissed out. We're trying to understand what is the mind. How does it work? How is it connected with the ego? What is the ego? So we look at the mind. When the mind is quiet, when the mind is busy and moving, that awareness which sees both states, are they the same? Are they different? What is a thought? What is a thought? Our whole lives are ruled by our thinking. Do we ever ask ourselves, what is a thought? Where is it coming from? Where is it going to? What does it look like? What color is it? Where is it? Who is thinking? And if we say, well, I am thinking, great, who am I? And then uncovering deeper and deeper levels of our psyche until the whole thing falls apart and we have a powerful recognition of the nature of the mind. Beyond thought, beyond concepts, beyond labels, beyond subject and object. Don't look so serious. This is good news. So that's the path. When we really, the ego completely drops away, what takes its place is liberation. In these texts called Nirvana. Freedom. We broke out the prison house of the ego. Now we're free. we're liberated. And then, you know, to help others also to become liberated. This is how. So that is the basic Four Noble Truths. Right? The situation we're in, the problem, the reason why we have this problem, the good news that it's not a permanent problem, that we are something beyond this problem, and how to recognize that, how to use it. Even if we cannot get into deep levels of meditation, at least we can be good people. At least we can be kind. At least we can be honest and trustworthy and think of others beyond ourselves and try to be more conscious, more aware in our lives, more mindful. All of us can do that. Doesn't matter what we believe or don't believe. Just to become better human beings and closer to our own potential. So, anyway, this was the original the original message the Buddha wanted to give out to the world through his first five disciples. This was the first thing he said. This is the what he said which set in motion the wheel of the Dharma, which is still turning 2,600 years later. So, if there are any questions on this, we have a few minutes.